living as if the purpose of life is to arrive safely at death. Run to the roar. Go after a dream that is destined to fail without divine intervention. Stop pointing out problems. Become part of the solution. Stop repeating the past and start creating the future. Face your fears. Fight for your dream. Grab opportunity by the mane and don't let go. Live like today is the first day and last day of your life. Burn sinful bridges and blaze new trails. Live for the applause of nail-scarred hands. Don't let what's wrong with you keep you from worshiping what's right with God. Dare to fail. Dare to be different. Quit holding out. Quit holding back. Quit running away. Chase the lion.
Well, hey, my name is CJ, pastor at the Shore Church. I'm so excited that you're here. If it's your first time with us, we got a guest for you in the back. A gift for you in the back. As you can tell from my voice, I'm a little, I got a head cold. And so normally I would shake hands at the back, but I don't think you want that gift, do you? So I don't want you sick so that you can come back next week and we can continue our series, Chase the Lion. So I'm sorry for being antisocial. It's in your best interest, all right? So today we are in this series, Chase the Lion. And we were doing that last song that says, Our God is the Lion of Judah. And this series has been about chasing big things. And every once in a while, isn't it great just to chase God in worship? Because I'm telling you right now, the things that will fall down in your life once you go to Him and worship, that's a big lion to chase, and that's an amazing thing to do. And I'm so glad that you're here doing it with us. And you can do that on your own at any time. You should definitely do that. Now, if it's your first time with us, man, I'm so glad that you're here. But today is a little bit different. We don't normally do service the way I'm about to do it, because today is a special day. I've got a big old announcement today. I've been teasing you guys for a little while now, kind of going, hey, hemming and hawing around it. And for years, we as a church have been meeting here at Brookside, and we love Brookside, but we've been praying, God, what is next for us as a church? Are we going to get a home that we can use that is dedicated facility for church? And I'm here to tell you that 2017 is the year that that happens. That's pretty awesome, right? It's here, and you guys are going, well, where is it? What is it? Well, how can I look at it? Can I drive by it? I'll one-up you. Let me show you a video of this new place. Check it out. Church family, I am so excited to be where I am right now. I am standing in the middle of our miracle. For a couple of years now, we've been praying for a permanent home for our church. And I am here right now shooting this video. A place with great childcare, clean, safe environments, comfortable chairs instead of the metal folding chairs we're used to, and doors between the lobby and the sanctuary. It's incredible. And so why don't you take a look at this facility with me? Pretty exciting stuff, isn't it, right? Okay, so you guys may be going, well, when, how, what, when? Okay, here, let me answer some of your questions right off the bat. This property is located on Fruitville Road, right on Fruitville Road, 47,000 cars a day go by right by the front door. That's awesome, right? That's a lot more than Shade Avenue on a Sunday morning that we currently have right now. So it's a tremendous opportunity, excuse me, for us to reach out to the world around us, to have opportunity in that is just incredible. I noticed you guys cheered when you saw cushions on the pews, right? That's pretty awesome. Like, I don't get to sit down, so it doesn't bother me at all. But I love the doors. My goodness, doors that close and everything. It's great. Because right now, if you get a cup of coffee, I know about it back here, right? Like, we can hear everything. So that is so, so exciting. We're going to lease this facility from the current owners. We are working on all the details and everything on what we want to do to improve. And so we've got a need for sound, video, lighting, upgrade our children's spaces in there. And so we've set a goal of $200,000 to go in and do all of that kind of stuff. We as a church can do that. And then our move-in date, you guys excited for this? Our goal is Easter of this year, which is April 16th. That's pretty incredible, isn't it? So we've got a tight timeline to get all this stuff done and the money raised. No more cheers. What happened? What happened to you guys? You were my other half for so long. All right, but it really is a great, great opportunity. But before we look forward to what this is going to be, I've got to rewind the tape for a little while for you guys, because 5 years and 1 month ago, our church almost did not start. Did you know that? Like none of this would be happening if certain events hadn't fallen into place. You see, 5 years and 1 month ago was December of 2011. Our launch day was on January 29th of 2012, so we're celebrating our fifth anniversary in 2 weeks. We're going to be 5 years old. It's our Vision Sunday. We have cupcakes and a party, and we have a lot of fun because it's our birthiversary, you know, whatever kind of thing that we're doing on that. So we share vision, and I'm really excited about that, to share that with you. But if you rewind 6 weeks before our launch, we almost didn't make it. You see, in mid-December, we had a $10,000 shortage on our fundraising goal, and we had 2 weeks to make it happen. 2 weeks, $10,000. I don't know about you, but that's a lot, don't you think? That's a lot to come up with in 2 weeks. And so that was our lion. That was the lion we had to chase. That was the thing that in front of us that we didn't know what to do. And that lion's name was 2 weeks and $10,000. And so we started to pray. There's a small group of us in a living room, knowing and believing that God would change the world through us if we were given the opportunity, and we sacrificed and we gave. And over the course of that next 2 weeks, money started to come in, and on the 14th day, the last $1,000 came into our account, and we were able to move forward with the launch process, and the shore happened. Isn't that awesome? That's good news. Now, each and every one of you are a product of that sacrificial giving that people made 5 years and 1 month ago. Their downline, or their ripple effect, you guys know when you throw a rock in a pond, it just kind of ripples out? That one action that they took, about a dozen or so people, to invest in the future of an unknown pastor in an unknown church in an unknown city, they threw that rock in the pond, and the ripple effect has been incredible. Hundreds of people have met Christ right here in this cafetorium. That's not even a word, man. But it's happened. In these metal chairs, people have heard the gospel. Kids have committed their life to Christ all over this campus because we've used so many different rooms for our kids' ministries. Thousands upon thousands of people have been affected, and hundreds of thousands of dollars have been given to missions, local, national, and international. But it started 5 years and 1 month ago when about a dozen people decided, I'm going to step in. We are a direct result of them. One of them was my grandfather. His name is Willis. Willis Hankey. He passed away 2.5 years ago. But he can't see you. Well, he can see you now from heaven, right? But you can't see him now, but you can sure feel his effects, can't you? You see, my children, that's their great-grandfather. They don't know him. They wouldn't remember him. But they feel his effects every day. There's always a downline. There's always a ripple effect. In the Old Testament, there's a woman named Rahab. She was she didn't have the best reputation in town, if you know what I mean. And she wasn't a Jewish woman. In fact, the Israelites were coming, and they were attacking her city. She hid some Israelite spies. And she said, hey, remember me when I... And she took that act of kindness towards them, and they escaped, and the city came. The Israelites attacked the city. They spared her and her family. She becomes a follower of Jehovah, a Jewish person, and four generations later is King David from her family line. See, there's always ripple effects to even the smallest actions that we take. For Rahab, it was just helping someone out in their time of need, which led to King David, which eventually came the line of Jesus, which affects all of us, right? She made one little decision. There's ripple effects everywhere. And everything we do sets off a chain of events. Every seed that we sow in our life, we will harvest it, won't we? And 5 years and 1 month ago, there was a group of people that decided to sow into an unknown field with their hard-earned money, and it's resulted in hundreds of people coming to Christ as a result. And God's doing incredible things. And that $10,000 has been multiplied over and over again. We've been able to, as a church, do that for other churches now in other cities around the nation that we've been able to invest in and make an impact in those cities. And our ripple effect is continuing. Mark Batterson talks about this in his book. He says this: sometimes the seeds of your dreams don't germinate for months or years or decades. But if we plant and water, God will give the increase in due time. Why? Because you cannot break the law of sowing and reaping. It will make or break you. We cannot break the law of sowing and reaping. What we put into the ground will come out of the ground. You plant corn, what's coming back? Corn. You plant tomatoes, what's getting you? Tomatoes. Did somebody say corn? We need to work on some seed. We need to work on your biology, all right? You plant corn, you get corn. You plant tomatoes, you get tomatoes. The same is true in every area of our life. You want to grow spiritually? Start opening up your Bible and plant the seed. Spend time in prayer. This is day 8 of a 21-day fast. We've got 14 more days to go. And I'm telling you, that's one of the ways we sow into our life spiritually. And I'm going to invite you to join me in this fast. Fast something. Fast a meal. Fast desserts. Fast something with me. And you're going, TJ, I didn't get it from the beginning, so I probably should just grab it next year. No. 14 days of fasting is better than 0 days. Just start today. Start to sow today, because tomorrow you will reap a harvest. But you've got to start today. The same thing is true in your marriage. You want a better marriage? Start sowing in selflessness and respect and love and compassion and servanthood. And one day you're going to reap the harvest of a healthy marriage. And it doesn't happen from day one, right? Like the day you get married, your marriage, well, that's probably the only day your marriage is perfect. But then from then on, you got to work on it, right? And you sow those seeds and eventually you'll reap the harvest. Same is true financially. We put in the ground good financial decisions. We start saving, staying out of debt, and eventually you'll reap the harvest of the life that you've always wanted financially. Does that make sense? It happens again and again in our health, in the way we eat or work out. But it's also true generationally. My grandfather sowed seeds into this place, and he's making an impact, leaving a legacy. Even though you don't know his name until I told you today, you're feeling his impact. And I wonder what kind of seeds we as a church could sow today to make an impact down the road. What's the city of Sarasota supposed to look like? Let's sow the seeds today to make that happen. What's supposed to be going on in your children's lives as they grow older, to grow in their relationship with Christ, right? Let's sow those seeds today. That's what we need to do as a church. And so the law of sowing and reaping will make or break us, because we cannot break the law of sowing and reaping. Paul says so in the book of Galatians, chapter 6. He says this: don't be misled. You cannot mock the justice of God. What does that mean? He's talking about sowing and reaping. He goes, what you put in, you'll get out. You can't break that law. It's an impossible law to break. You will always harvest what you plant every single time, whether it's positive or whether it's negative. We will always harvest what we plant. Those who live only to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature. That's a negative example of sowing and reaping, right? But he goes on the other side, and he says, but those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life from the Spirit. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. Let's keep sowing good things into our life. Let's sow into the lives of the people around us. And he says that here, at just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we do not give up. At just the right time, not my time, because if it was my time, we'd have a building already, right? If it's his time, he's the one lining up. He's the one preparing it. And he says, at just the right time, we will reap a harvest if we don't give up. Keep sowing, keep watering, keep caring. And he wraps it up like this. Therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone, especially those in the family of faith. When you sow, don't sow just for you, sow for the person beside you. Sow for the next generation of believers that will meet at the Shore Church. Sow for the city that you desire to see, that you're praying to see. Sow into that. That's our lion as a church, is to see our city change to reflect the face of Christ. That's our lion, and we sow the seeds week after week, year after year, decade after decade to see that happen. We need to keep sowing. And this is not a sow $10 so that you can get $100 back kind of a sermon. I'm not that kind of preacher. If you guys know me, you know that, right? This is, I'm blessed to be a blessing. I'm blessed so that I can change the world around me. God's given me input and resources and abilities and talents, and every single one of us, he's given us that. And he says, I'm blessing you so that you can change the world around you. I'm blessing you so that the people in your life will not see you as the same, so that you can keep be a blessing to them, so that you can point them to me, so that he gets the glory. 2 Corinthians, written by the same author, Paul, he's just writing, instead of writing to Galatia, he's writing to the church in Corinth. And this is his second letter to the church in Corinth, and he says this, for God is the one who provides the seed for the farmer, and then the bread to eat. So you see this principle of sowing and reaping. He's given them the seed so they can sow, and then at the end, there's bread to eat. But what's in the middle? A lot of hard work, right? You got to sow the seed. You got to water the seed. You got to care for it. You got to till the soil. You got to do all these things. You got to keep that seed safe until eventually you get seed in return, and then you can make your bread. You have something to eat, right? And God says, I've given you something. I've given you a talent. I've given you a job. I've given you a family. I've given you an influence. Use it. Put hard work into it, and eventually on the other end, you're going to eat. And he says, in the same way, just like the farmer has that process, he will provide and increase your resources, then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. See, the great harvest wasn't like great harvest of fat bank accounts. Now, it's not bad if you have one, but he says, I want you to be generous. The harvest in you, I want it to be generosity. Generosity. And many of us, we say, well, God, if I'm blessed to be a blessing, start blessing me, and then I'll start being blessing others. Like, God, I don't have anything to bless others with. Yeah, anybody else felt that way once? Right? Every once in a while, I get that way. God, if I had more, I could give more. But you know what it's about? It's not about asking for more. It's being faithful with what you already have. It's not about the bigness of what you could do, but it's the smallness of what you currently have and what you're doing with it that really matters. In Boston, Massachusetts, there's a memorial to the victims of the Holocaust, a very dark time in our world history, unspeakable acts of horror. And there's six glass towers there. And on each one of the glass towers, there's an inscription. And on the first five, it's pretty dark. It hurts to read the descriptions there. But on the sixth one, it is different. It's a message of hope. And here's what it says. It says, Ilsa, a childhood friend of mine, once found a raspberry in the camp and carried it in her pocket all day to present to me that night on a leaf. Imagine a world in which your entire possession is one raspberry and you gave it to your friend. Well, God, I don't have very much to bless the people around me. I wish I had a little bit more. If we have a raspberry, we have enough, right? If we have even the smallest amount, we should use it. And there's so many things we can do. It doesn't cost you anything to smile at someone. It doesn't cost you anything to help someone move, right? It doesn't cost you anything to encourage someone with your words. Even when we're at our lowest, God can still be his best. He can still use us. I love this part in the book. Mark Batterson picks up on this story, and he says, the true measure of a gift is what you gave up to give it. So for some people, a raspberry is nothing, but for some people, a raspberry is everything. And you can put dollars and cents on that if you want. One raspberry isn't much unless it's all you have. Big dreams often start with small acts of kindness. It's powerful when we're on the receiving end, but it's even more wonderful when we're on the giving end. All of us have a world to impact. And your world may not be real big, or your world may be extremely large, but all of us have a world to impact. We have a ripple effect happening in our life. Every decision is setting off a chain of events for us to impact the world around us in a positive way. So we sow good day after day after day. We sow that good into the soil of our lives, and we reap a harvest someday. And those people who, at the beginning of our church, began to sow with that in 2 weeks, $10,000, they may not even know the harvest that they've been able to reap, but it's been big. It's been effective. God's been doing some great things in this place. But it started with them sowing generosity. Blessed to be a blessing. But more important than the financial end of things is the spiritual side. Here's what I mean by that. It does not matter what we're able to give or the impact we've made unless you yourself have a relationship with Jesus Christ. You see, at the beginning of our lives, there was a separation between us and God. And that separation was called sin. There was a gap there. And God had a plan for your life, and it didn't involve that sin. But so he had to find a way to come back into relationship with us, and he sent his son Jesus to pay the price so that we didn't have to. And because of the sacrifice of Jesus, the debt of sin is paid, and we can have right standing, right relationship with God. That's a really important part of who we are as a church. And if you're here this morning, maybe it's your first time, second time, maybe you've been here for a long time. God's got a destiny and a plan for you, and it starts with salvation. It starts with a relationship with him. If you're here this morning, you haven't done that, I'm going to pray with you. And I want you to take a moment to give your life to him. And the message isn't over yet, but this is such a big part of who we are that I just have to put this in here. So would everybody in here maybe close your eyes, just so there's no distractions, no one moving around, just a quiet moment between us and God. If you're here today and you've never made the decision to follow Jesus with your entire life, you've never said, God, forgive me my sins, I want a fresh start in you, this is your morning to do that. And I'm telling you, this one event will set off generational change in your family. Why don't you pray this prayer with me? God, thank you so much for your great grace for me. Thank you for giving me of my sins, and thank you for sending your son Jesus to do that. I want to be made new in you and to live out the purpose that you have for me. In your name we pray, and everybody says, amen. Why don't you put your hands together for the people who just prayed that prayer? That's a really big moment. See, we can talk church and big all day. Like $10,000 in 2 weeks was a tipping point for our church. But that prayer is the tipping point for your life. Not just the church, not just dollars, not just buildings, not any of this. It's your life and eternity. That's the tipping point. And that's something that we as a church continually pursue. Now, when you came in, you got a packet of information. And again, message isn't over. I'm just doing like our wrap. If you've been around here for a while, you're like, oh, he's wrapping it up. I'm not wrapping it up. I'm not done, all right? I'm going to wrap it up for 15 minutes, if that's okay with you. All right, good. All right. So if you came and you got a packet of information, if you prayed that prayer with me, I want you to mark on the bottom left-hand side my decision today, because I want to be praying for you this week. And I also want to send you an email. If you could write your name on there and your email address legibly, I'd love to send that to you. And if it's your first, second time, you can mark that on there. If you're interested in joining a Connect group, which is our small group system here, mark that on there. Or I've been talking about your destiny, how God uniquely made you. And we as a church are so dedicated to helping you find that. We've created an entire track called the Growth Track, four classes to help you find that. Mark that box if you want to be a part of that, or serving at the Shore, you can do that as well. And in a moment, buckets are going to go by. You're going to put that card in the buckets. This is also, when the buckets go by, it's our opportunity to give. And this is where I want to talk for a little while longer. But before I do, I want to show you how we give, just in case I forget later on, okay? All right, so check this out. We can give in person at the back of the lobby with a kiosk. envelopes that you came in with. Online at shortchurch.com is what I do because it's super easy. And then also another one that's super easy is text to give 84321. If you text any amount to 84321, you'll get a link. You can register your card, and from then on out, you just text the amount. That's it. It's super, super simple. And that's how we give here at the Shore. Okay, so I've been talking to you guys about this building indirectly for like over a month now. Do you guys remember in December I came to you and I said, hey, I just need you guys to be praying because we have an opportunity and I need you to pray with me and pray about what you can do to make this building happen. And so I asked you to do that. Well, after one of those services, a couple came up to me and they said, TJ, we're going to be praying just like you asked. I said, that's awesome. Thank you. And they said, but will you give us an exact dollar amount? And which I'm like, I don't know a dollar amount. And they're like, well, just give us what you think it'll be. And I said, $200,000. And I said, okay, we'll be praying together. They said, okay, we'll be praying. I said, okay, we're praying. And it turns out $200,000 is exactly what we need to make this happen. And so we prayed. And they're praying. And they got a hold of me a couple weeks later. And they said, hey, TJ, can we meet together? And I said, yeah, you've been praying. I've been praying. Let's get together. And they came to my office. And they walked in my office, and they gave me a quarter. This quarter, right here, and they put it in my hand, and they said, TJ, we would like to give a quarter. And I was like, thank you very much. Probably didn't need a meeting for that. That's okay, right? Here's a quarter. But then they kept talking, and then I got it. I got it. It took a minute for me to get it, but then I got it. They said, we want to give a quarter of every dollar. I was like, well, that's a lot. That's 200,000 quarters. That's $50,000 if you're not very good at math. It's 50,000. And they said, we want to give a quarter in the first quarter as a matching fund. So they want to give a quarter in a quarter. Does that make sense to everybody? A quarter in a quarter? So here's what that means. That means that every single dollar we give towards our building fund between now and March 31st is doubled up to $50,000. That's pretty awesome, right? Incredible, incredible. And I just love how they presented this. And so when someone else heard about this quarter in a quarter, they dropped off 100 pounds of quarters at our office. And I was like, whoa, there's a lot of quarters. I'm like, and they're like, here's my quarters. And so they dropped it off, and we've got those quarters in the lobby over there. And here's what I'd like you to do. On your way out of here, it's right next to the Connect groups, and so you can sign up with a Connect group and then grab your quarter and then go. I want you to take one of these quarters, and I don't want you to just stick it in your pocket and forget about it, put it in a soda machine or something, but I want you to put it in a place that you'll remember it. I keep mine in my wallet because I want this quarter to remind you of the destiny that you are creating, the seeds that you're sowing, the legacy that you're leaving, the legacy. Because every single one of us are creating a ripple effect. Now, I've been at this new building probably a total of 4 hours over the last month. So that's not very long, right? And I was shooting with our video guy, Nick, the promo video you just saw, the kind of tour guide video. And a girl came up and knocked on the door, and you could tell she was distraught. She was crying, and she had tears in her eyes. And she said, my car broke down, and I need to get downtown, and I have this case that I need to go to, and all these things just absolutely, just, you know, just the ugly cry face, like, ah, you know, one of those. And Nick looked at me, and we're in the middle of a shoot, and we're busy, and I said, man, let's just shut it down. Let's go take her. So we jump in the car, and she's telling us some things going on in her life, and like anybody, she's made mistakes, and she doesn't want to live that life anymore. So I told her about Jesus, and we got to pray with her, and we dropped her off, and on the way, and I invited her to church. You always invite people to church, right? Okay. And on the way back, Nick goes, well, that was cool. And it hit me. It just hit me. I'm like, what are the odds that her car would break down right there at that moment, at the exact hour that we were standing there shooting a video? And it's like God just confirmed to me, hey, if you do this, I'll send people your way. I'll give you ability to minister to people. I'll give you opportunity. You just need to get there. And that was with two of us there. Imagine if hundreds of us are there and there's the opportunity across the board. that God could do something great. Pretty incredible, huh? So I shared this story with our kingdom builders about the quarters and the ministry, and because I gave our kingdom builders a tour of the facility this week. Because our kingdom builders, here's what a kingdom builder is. It's a person who tithes. They give 10%, which is what God asks us to do with our finances. And they give above and beyond their 10% to support God projects, to build God's kingdom. And so they're on the front lines funding all of this. So I decided, you know what? I'm going to invite our kingdom builders, and I'm going to give them a personalized tour and talk to them, let them in first. So they've got quarters already. They're all amped and ready to go. But after it was over, one of the kingdom builders came to me and they said, TJ, I wish I could do a $50,000 gift. And I just told him, you have no idea. Like, you literally have no clue how this came about. Because it looks like, oh, some wealthy person just stroked a check. Not even close. See, that couple that came to me, they came to me and they said, hey, we haven't had a home church in a long time. But we know that 10% of every dollar belongs to God. And so we opened an account and faithfully for years, just started putting it over. They said, it's not ours, it's his, and we want to use it for his kingdom. And God gave them the inspiration in this church at this moment to go, here it is. And you know what the crazy thing is? That account started before our church did. God's God's been taking this account and this building and this church and lining it up for this moment. And if that does not give you a sense of destiny, I do not know what will. It's incredible. And you may be going, well, I can't give $50,000. I bet you could. It may take you a decade to get there, but you can do it, right? Any one of us could. Maybe 20 years, maybe your lifetime. I don't know. But any one of us could if we're faithful in sowing right where we are. So in a moment, buckets are going to be passed. You guys know how to give. There's four ways to do it. And I'm going to ask you to ask God, what do I do? And then do it. Don't argue with him when he says do this. Just respond, right? And don't give before you pray. You've got to seek him on this. Because I know that he's going to ask each one of us to sow. So I'm going to pray over you. And I want God to do something great. And if you want to give specifically towards the building project, in any one of these four ways to give up here, you can put it in the person in the back, put it to the Kingdom Builders Fund. On the envelope, check the Kingdom Builders box. If you text Kingdom Builders and the amount, you know what I'm saying? You can do it online, put it in the Kingdom Builders Fund. That way we know it's specifically designated to go towards that building fund. But here's what we can't do. We can't take what we would normally give and just slide it over to the building because that's cool. Because we do a lot of ministry out of what is already given. It would be like buying a new car, but you can't afford the gas, right? Like that we need both. Because there's no point of having a new building if we have no ability to reach out to the world around us and serve people. We should definitely stay here if that's the case. But we need to do both, don't we? We need to build God's kingdom. But we also need to make sure that our ministries stay running, that we keep preaching the gospel, that we keep making that happen. So with that, let me pray over you guys. And Leah and I have already sowed our seed into this. We believe in it. We were one of the first ones to give towards it. We really, really love what's happening here. And we believe that we're on the edge of something great. That if $10,000 in 2 weeks, 5 years ago could do this, imagine what $200,000 by the end of March could do in the next decade of our church. I believe in it. So let me pray over you guys. God, thank you so much for these great people. Thank you for the gift you've given us to sow into the next generation, to leave a legacy in the city of Sarasota. And I pray, God, as we give, Father, that our hearts will be prepared to see through the eyes of faith of what you're going to do in our city, that we're sowing for the city we dream it to be. We're sowing for the church we dream to be. We're sowing for the next generation and to create environments where they get to encounter you, God. Thank you, Father. In your name we pray. And everybody says, amen.
Hey, why don't you guys stand up as we lead you guys on one more song? And hands together, please.